Hi Vikas, how are you?
Hey, hi Bharath. I'm doing good. How are you? Are you
Thank
feeling?
you, I'm good.
Are you feeling better now?
Yeah, much better.
Okay.
Throat is still recovering.
Okay.
How are you finding these sessions generally?
That there. I mean, more than what I expected, to be honest. So yeah, and I'm getting a lot of insights. And I mean, I did some courses within my organization. Capgemini has a lot of in-house courses, right? But nothing that started in this way. They were all always like an overview or just an overview of AI or deep learning or something like that. But nothing that starts with the basics and fundamentals.
Yeah, I think that's what I also found when I was learning. I was foolish enough to spend quite a lot of money on taking up multiple courses. What I felt was, though they give you some bit of, so just as how we are learning, what they would do is they'll just say, okay, call the linear regression, do a dot fit, and do predict, and that's about it. And they quickly move on. So it doesn't really cover many fundamentals, but I'm glad that you're liking this.
I think, I mean, I look forward to the Saturday sessions more than. The past weeks have been very hectic in the office as well, so I haven't been able to sort of catch up on a lot of stuff. But still, I try to read up on Thursday, Friday evening whenever I get time, and I just want to. I mean, I don't want to break the cycle at least till December, so till our break comes, right? So I don't want to miss any session, any. I mean, how much ever busy I am, I can always go back to the material and just revise everything, but it's important to be present in the session as well.
Yes, I'm really glad, and I think whenever I hear these kind of things, I also tend to get a little motivated to record better videos. So
No,
keep going.
I think Bharat, this is going to become something big if you just persist, maybe for the next 6 months or a year or so. I'm sure we'll have a lot of other participants coming in, because I don't think there's anything out there which starts like this. I mean, the way you start it, right? That is the first 5 6 weeks is very important, because that gets you hooked. And then the way that you've organized it has all the ingredients for becoming that sort of a course. So I think if you just continue with this in the next year or so, you might be able to like kind of streamline it bit more and
Yeah,
get
that's
to.
the final idea, that I'll do a couple of batches more and perhaps put it as a full-fledged package if any corporate want to take this up. My office has asked if I can streamline this because they want their leaders to learn for sure. Because their decision-making would change the course of organization. And if they are unaware of what data can do for them, then they will always end up taking wrong type of choices. So they have asked me to streamline it into something that can be delivered over 3 hours. So 1 hour each week. So I'm putting something together for them.
Yeah,
Let's see what else. They won't
that
be
will
able
work.
to do it, but all a leader needs to know is what is possible now. And then they also need to figure out when someone gives them a wrong type of story, they should be able to tell what is possible, what is not, and what does it take to do machine learning in an organization. Anyway, so where have you guys reached till last time we left? It was with CART, and CART was our foundation for moving ahead. Are you guys comfortable with basic intuition around CART? Even if you're not able to memorize or do it without looking, all I want you guys to reach a stage is where you intuitively understand what CART is, its drawing lines, creating trees, and then with those trees, what does it do? And if you're able to even Google and then piece together an algorithm, that's more than enough at this stage. So idea is, we have now moved from an individual algorithms. So we had a regression algorithm, a logistic regression, KNN, naive Bayes. Now we are moving to algorithms which don't care about whether it's a regression problem or a classification problem. Now we don't care about one single model as well. That's what I want to cover this class. And then you will see a couple of months down the line, you won't even care what the model is. All you will do is you would not worry about pre-processing the data. You would not worry about what model to use. All you'll have to do is build a network of something called a neural network, and you throw the data at it. The network would decide what to do. It will decide the pipeline. It will decide what to clean, what not to clean. It will decide what features are important and what features are garbage and discard them out. It will decide which is the best model to use as well. So it will take form of whatever you have learned so far. But for you to intuitively understand that, all of the history of whatever we have learned so far should be fairly clear. And that's why we have spent so far, I think this is the 11th week, we have spent around 2.5 months learning all those. So if there are any questions on CART before I start on ensemble methods, I would want to ask if there is anything you want to ask on CART or anything we have discussed in past. Okay, if no questions, then in this session, I would like to give you an intuition of what ensemble methods are. We'll see. Instead of trees, how about growing an entire forest which have thousands of these trees? And with this, we develop an intuition around two techniques used to stack together multiple models, independent models. These would be bagging techniques and boosting techniques. And then a quick hands-on exercise. So continuing with our tradition of classifying everything as a regression or a classification problem in supervised, ensemble methods don't care whether what type of problem you're solving. It might be regression, it might be classification. The way these work is exactly the same. And somehow they arrive at an answer regardless whether it's a regression problem or a classification problem. So usually, ensemble methods are machine learning methods for combining predictions from multiple separate models. So far, we had training data. We put it through a model. Model learns, and then we pass testing data, and then we see how well it performs on testing. Now, what we are moving towards is we put multiple models together. And by the way, I've minimized this. If you see that there are any participants in waiting room, just let me know. I'll allow them in. Okay. So now what we are going to do is we'll take n number of models. All of these would be independent models, independent of each other. And we'll train all of them together with the same type of data. And we'll take predictions from each of these models. And then somehow combine these predictions in a way such that overall prediction is better than the best of these models. So if model 2 was the best, it should perform better than the best. Otherwise, there is no point in combining. We might choose a best model and use it all throughout. So the central motivation is rooted under the fact that, it's an empirical fact. There is no theory or theorem behind it, but it's a empirical evidence that when we let n number of models work independently and then take a generic vote amongst those models, the outcome would be much better than any individual model. Now I have tried to explain it, why it works, on why that even though, let's say, model 1, model 2, model 3, all of them are at some suboptimal performance. Let's say all of them perform at around 70%. Why is that the combined prediction might still be 100%? So let's understand it a little more concretely with an example. So think of you having 10 different models, each with an independent accuracy of 70%. And you have these, you have the data to pass. So data looks like this. You might have number of columns here. And finally, what you're doing is with each of these models, you are predicting this. So what I've done is, let's say we use model one, and then it is allowed to learn on this data, and now we are predicting with model one. Let's say the first row, it predicts correctly as n, y. Second row, it doesn't predict correctly, and so on and so forth. So because this model accuracy is 70%, it can be roughly said that 70% of time it predicts correctly. Ultimately, that's what accuracy score is, how many times it predicts correctly. So out of, if these were 100 rows of data, it would correctly classify 70 of them. Same with M2. It might not be same 70 which it predicts correctly, because these are all independent models. Each of the model, however, would predict 70% of the data correctly. Now something curious happens. If you stack together all the predictions like this, so if I just take this row, and let's say among these 10, I want to vote. So in here, vote would mean, let's say M1, M2, M3, M1 predicted this correctly, M2 incorrectly, M3 correctly. So it can, using binomial theorem, it's a very simple formula that given individual accuracy of 70%, that means this has 0.7 probability of being correct. Given every independent element has 0.7% of being correct, what is the probability of 50% of it being correct? That means at least 50% of my models should predict this correctly. That is 100%. All the time, regardless how many times you do it, at least 5 models would have predicted it correctly. So I've put together like this. So if this is incorrect, if these 3 are incorrect, rest of them predicted correctly. Here, this row, everyone got it right except for this one. So vertically, 70% of data would be incorrect. 70% of data would be predicted correctly by each model. But now that we have stacked together and I take a vote, I walk away with being correct all the time. So though I have used models which are individually 70% correct, if I put them to vote and say, what do majority of my models say? Majority of my models say it's Y, and I put a Y. So if I do that way, I end up walking away with 100% accuracy. So this is the intuition behind why we would like to stack together multiple models instead of just using a model and fighting about accuracy. Now in here, it allows me certain flexibilities. Like I no longer care about every model to be highly accurate. I can, as long as these are fairly accurate and I'm stacking enough number of them, as long as I put them to vote, I'll always get a correct answer. Now this is a very, very simple technique, but very counterintuitive on how can models with very, very low accuracy. These are often called weak learners because they don't learn very strongly. That's why these are called weak learners. When we stack together multiple weak learners, we have an amazing model accuracy. So this type of, this technique of stacking together multiple models and then combining their output is called ensemble methods. There are different ways of stacking. Here I've stacked them parallelly. There is a way to stack them serially as well. We'll come to that. But the central idea remains the same, that a combination of models would often perform much better than any single model. So with this clear, there is one particular way in which an ensemble can be created. That particular method is, that particular way leads to something called a random forest. So we have seen what CART is. CART takes some data and converts them into a tree format. Now, if we change this data, your tree might, the way your tree shapes up might be very different. So because each of the branching depends on where you chop this data. And where you chop this data ultimately is a function of Gini impurity for each of the broken down subsets of data. So if I break it down here, and that results in this tree, that would mean the first job here results in two branches, this and this. This branch corresponding to the top part of data, this branch corresponding to bottom part of data. Now, it might so decide to branch here because this might be the most optimal way of branching. And your algorithm knows this by recursively calculating Gini impurity. Now, I've already discussed Gini impurity to quite some detail, and I've also run through a very basic toy example. If you are not clear at this part, when you again rewatch, take a small segue, go watch those videos and watch that particular video on Gini impurity, and then you can come back and then rewatch this. But the central idea here is your tree shape ultimately is governed by your data. Small changes to data leads to very drastic change in the way your tree ends up looking. That's because every time you change even a small thing, if I put this row, if I take off this row from the data set, that means it will have to recalculate all the Gini impurities at every possible feature level again, and then do branching. And it might result, so the tree which started like this might end up looking like this if we change the data. So we somehow exploit this property of trees. And then what we do is we grow multiple types of trees, each a little independent of each other. And for now, stay with me. Like, I have not explained why do we need different type of trees or why do we need all trees. So think of a forest as a group of trees, hundreds and thousands of trees. Now, if these hundreds and thousands of trees are all same, their predictions would also be same. If their predictions are same, all of this would be right and all of this would be wrong at same time. So every tree would predict the same thing and mispredict the same thing. And we will not be able to utilize this fact. So to utilize this particular property of combining our models, these models have to be little independent of each other. That means if M predicts it correctly, M1, model 1 predicts it correctly, we want model 2 to do its own thing and not be dependent on what model 1 said. It should do its own thing and arrive whether it's correct or wrong. Randomly, if some models predict it incorrectly, some predict it correctly, we combine them and we walk away with 100% accuracy. To utilize this, again, we would want all our models to behave a little independently. And that's the reason why we want different type of trees. Now, how do we get different type of trees now? By changing the data. But here, we have just one data set. How do we change it? So we do that by sampling. So imagine if you have 10 rows of data, I randomly pick up 4 rows of data and then make a tree out of it. I put those 4 rows back into the original data set and again shuffle the entire data set and again randomly pick up 4. So it need not be 4. So if you have 10 rows of data, you can pick up all the 10 rows of data with replacement. That in sense, you will pick up one row, you'll put it back, you'll pick up second row, you'll put it back, you'll pick up third row. That might lead to some rows being repeated. So that way of repeatedly sampling your data with replacement, that is, you pick up rows from the data, put it back and again pick up, and you sample the data. So you end up with multiple data sets, each coming from this data set, but each a little different from each other now. All of the data has same rows. So if your data was this 5 rows, let's say you pick up, let's call them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So imagine this as you have a bag with 5 tokens in it. You shuffle all of these, each token is labeled 1 to 100, let's say. You have 100 tokens. So each token, I'm just assuming each token to be one row of data. All you're doing is, you need, if you want to grow 100 trees, you need to have 100 data sets. All you have is a bag of tokens containing 100 tokens. Each token would be a line. So you shuffle this bag, pick up one token, put it back, pick up another time, put it back, pick up another time. You do this 100 times. So you would have 100 rows of data now, but because you're putting each token back, shuffling and then picking again, it might be that you will have more than oh, you're not able to see any images on the slide?
I can see, Bharath, but it's really light. It's not clearly visible. I have to, you know, adjust my laptop in order to see that.
Oh, is that with everyone?
I can't see any image.
I can't see any image.
Can't see any image.
Okay, what can I do? I can change the background of this. So let me go back to the... Are you guys able to download these slides by any chance?
Not tried.
So if you can download and see it on your screen, then also it's not visible properly.
Just one moment, Bharath, I'll try.
Sure.
So if we view the slides on the website, the images are visible.
Oh, perhaps it's the way Zoom is rendering these then. So would it help like if I talk, okay, let me change the background and then see.
We can certainly see it now.
Where were we here? Let's say I change the background to... Then that removes all the text. Okay, is this any better?
Yeah, we can see it now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what we were doing so far is we somehow have to take multiple models, each a little different from each other. And guys, if you think that you want to say something and I'm not able to monitor this chat, please interrupt me any point of time.
But Bharath, just one question before we go ahead. So when you say models, right, all these models, are they all CART models or they can be other algorithms as well?
They can be any algorithm you want, but okay. This particular model called random forest depends on growing multiple trees. So essentially it is similar type of algorithm. It is an ensemble method in
but
which...
CART. Okay.
Yeah, in which we are growing multiple models, but if all of these models are decision trees, are grown using CART algorithm, then these multiple trees together form a forest called random forest. So you can choose anything. You can choose a linear regression here, a support vector machine here, and stack them together. But if we choose to use all decision trees, then the final algorithm is called a random forest.
Okay, so random forest is like a subset of ensemble methods?
Yeah, and it's a special case of ensemble where all of the models are decision trees.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Now, it so happens that stacking together any type of model would work, but it works the best when all of these are trees. Now, the reason for it, I'll come to later, why this works so wonderfully well when all of these are trees. But for now, for us to grow multiple number of trees, we have to make these trees a little different from each other. The way we make them a little different from each other is randomly sampling rows from your original data set. That causes each of the tree to be a little different, because we have seen that if we change the data slightly, your tree structure changes slightly. So imagine your trees growing in a different way like this. And you grow like hundreds, thousands often. You grow around 500 to 1,000 of these trees. Now you take these 1,000 predictions and take a vote and then decide which one is the best classification. And that would often beat any given single model you have learned so far. So this technique, 1 minute, let me quickly convert back the color. Is this, I know the color choice is very horrible and glaring to eye, but as long as you're able to make out the graphs or the diagrams, I'm fine with it.
No, same.
The same.
So black works better than the others. So what I'll do is I'll quickly change this text to white.
But do you want to try sharing from your site? Because that from there it is quite visible.
I was sharing initially from the slide site only, here directly. This okay. Is the site.
Yep. For me, it is clearly visible when I try to look directly from there.
Here on my screen, what you're seeing, are you able to see things clearly?
Only the lines and not the trees or graph completely.
Okay. So or if would it work faster if you guys open it at your end and I open it at my end, and then I keep a note of each slide I am on?
I think, yeah.
Okay, so I am on slide 10. So on slide 10, you would see your initial data set on the top. So think that you have A to J. Those are 10 columns. These would be your 10 features plus one target. And you have M number of rows. Now when we repeatedly resample this data, you might have row 1, 32, 69. And again, at some point of time, it might be 32 again. Because you're resampling it with replacement, so every time you take something out, you put it back and then again pick up something randomly, you might end up with data sets with multiple rows, often repeated multiple number of times. Generally, if there are n number of rows, if you do sampling with replacement, your square root n to the power 1 by p, and p is the number of times you pick up, is the number of times any row gets duplicated. Now you need not remember it, it's just some simple probability. If you calculate it on a piece of paper row by row, you can easily arrive at the same formula. But the intuition, the message I'm trying to drive is, using one single data set, we are creating now multiple data sets, each a little different from the original one. Because each is a little different from original one, we can have multiple trees now on each of these little different from each other data sets. And all of these trees are bound to be different. Now you might ask, if we have sampled with replacement, you have some number of data points which are duplicated and some numbers which might be totally not picked altogether. Won't that lead to a weak learner or a weak model? But that was the entire point. Now we don't care whether individual models are weak or strong. All we care about is each model should be different from each other and independent. So using this technique of resampling the data with replacement, we are able to arrive at data sets which are of similar size, but each a little different from each other. And because they are each a little different from each other, we can now grow trees which are a little different from each other. And now we don't even need to care whether each tree would perform well or not. As long as each of these trees performs something, we can always combine together and walk away with much, much higher accuracy than any individual tree. So combination of these trees is called random forest. And the method by which we resample this data repeatedly to generate subsequent multiple data sets, is the entire method is called bootstrap aggregation. So commonly, most of the people or most of the books do not refer it as bootstrap aggregation. They directly called it bagging. But bagging comes from these acronyms. So B-A-G-G from bootstrap, B-A-G-G from aggregation combined together, they call it a bag. 90% of the books or the literature or even the websites online, they call it just bagging. So think of bagging as creating multiple data sets from a single data set, each a little different from each other. How do you do it? You repeatedly resample it. In resampling, you're careful to resample with replacement. And then after you do this bagging, you grow trees on each of these data sets. Because these are little different from each other, your trees, the shape they take would be a little different from each other. And you don't care how good a tree is or how bad a tree is, because ultimately in an ensemble method, you'll combine all the predictions. So the end point is we get a lot of trees. All of these trees together is called a forest. Now we make a random forest, these forests little more diverse. So one step of diversity was by growing each tree on a little different data set. Now you remember CART, the way it branches is by repeatedly calculating Gini impurity for every possible cut of every possible feature. Now we make these trees even more diverse by allowing only few subset, a randomly chosen subset of features to be allowed for the branching decision to be made. So let's say originally, if we just have this data set and we grow a CART tree, how it would do it is it will calculate Gini impurity at this cut, this cut, this cut, this cut for A. It will calculate Gini impurity for B for every possible cut and so on until all the cuts are done. And finally, the cut, the chop, which gives us the best reduction in Gini impurity will be used to branch. Now we have put a constraint that for this branching, we do not make available all the features. We make available only a subset of features. Look at A, B, C, D, and perhaps E, and then decide which is the best cut. Amongst these four or five columns which we allow, Gini calculation would happen the same way. It will branch, and then at each node, we make another subset possible. Now, these subsets are also randomly chosen. Just like how we randomly chose rows, we allow a random subset of features to be available for the branching decision making to happen. What it does is, now we have quite a lot of trees each very, very diverse. One type of diversity comes because we have used a little different data set, because we have repeatedly resampled with replacement. Each of them are a little different from each other already. We add even more diversity by allowing only a random subset of features for every branching decision. Now, this causes your forest to be very, very rich. By richness, I mean every tree would be a little different from each other. And hence, we need not worry about overfitting as well. We need not worry about any performance at all. What happens if we allow to grow it unconditionally? We saw decision trees would definitely overfit. That means every decision tree always would have 100% accuracy on your training data, but your testing data tanks. Those accuracy scores tank because it has an overfit. Now, think of this carefully. A particular tree grown on this data set, if allowed to grow unrestrained, it will overfit. But what is it overfitting on? It's overfitting on only this part of data, because any single tree is not allowed the access to the original data set. None of these can overfit on the original data set. All they can overfit is on individual different data sets. And often this has a canceling effect of overfitting. So this tree might overfit on this, this tree might underfit on this, this tree might overfit on this, and this overfits, underfits, cancels out each other. And all the accuracies also, when combined together, you have much, much better accuracy. So that's the central big idea behind random forest, that we grow a bunch of trees. All of these trees are very, very different from each other. And out of this, because there is a lot of randomness involved, we randomly sample rows, and then we randomly sample columns for the branching decisions. And then we take predictions, and then we combine predictions. And that's the reason why this algorithm is called random forest. Random because it's random both in number of rows and the number of columns for individual model. And forest because it's a forest of multiple trees. So it is one of the most popular algorithms. If you see Kaggle, after an algorithm called XGBoost, the most popular winning algorithm, the algorithm which wins most of the competitions, are random forests. So that covers one way of stacking algorithms. We have stacked them parallelly. By parallelly, I mean the entire data set is broken down to multiple, is shuffled to give us multiple data sets, and then parallelly we train all of these together. An alternate way, now while this is called bagging, an alternate way of stacking together models is called boosting. So if you think of bagging as this, this is your entire data set, and then we create multiple data sets out of the original data set and grow trees on each of these and combine predictions from these. Boosting is a little different technique. Boosting is, we have a data set. Now each of these in bagging were allowed to grow unrestrained. That means these were very, very strong models individually. And strong models in sense, strong to an extent of overfit. But still somehow this works. In boosting, what happens is we take the data set, we grow a tree. Now this tree would be very, very shallow to start with. Now by the end of this discussion, I would hope that you can figure out by yourself why this is shallow. So I'll park that for now. If I forget to ask this question, please remind me to ask this. If you're not clear, I'll explain. So we start with taking a data set, we take a tree, and then let the tree predict. So output might be, it might have classified some correctly and some incorrectly. Now the ones which are classified incorrectly are given a higher preference. So your instruction to the next model would be, regardless, I don't care about rest of the data sets, but the data, but the points, the observations which were predicted incorrectly by the first model, now ensure those are predicted correctly. And then again, the output of this model again would classify correctly some more of them and some incorrectly. So this sequentially, we increase the weight of whatever is classified incorrectly and repeatedly pass them through models is known as boosting. Here, if you see in bagging, we have trained all of this parallelly. In boosting, we first pass the entire data through one model, take, and we somehow adds weight to our observations. That means our data set has changed a little bit. We have added weight. We have overweighted the things that were classified incorrectly. And this modified data set is pushed through another model. Again, we see what has been classified incorrectly. We again overweight certain observations which were classified incorrectly and again push through. If done enough number of times, imagine it as a sequential filter, removing away the noise. At the end of it, you'll have pure distilled model, which would have removed away most of the noise and would classify everything correctly. This is an alternate way of stacking together models. While bagging, we stack them parallelly. In boosting, we stack them sequentially. Just like in bagging, these models can be anything. These might be different. This might be linear regression. This might be support vector machine. This might be CART. Same way with bagging, these models can be anything. However, if we decide for all the models to be trees, then the final, this entire thing of first bagging, then growing multiple trees, and adding randomness to the branching decisions, the entire algorithm is called random forest. Same way, in boosting, if we decide all the models sequentially tagged together be trees, then it's generally accepted method of doing boosting is stacking together multiple trees. Now, that doesn't stop you from doing your own experiment by adding together multiple different types, but I have never seen anyone do that. So I'll stick to trees. There are reasons why different type of models are not stacked serially, because the way, let's say your first model was linear regression, the noise part of it, the parts which were not classified correctly or ones which with more amount of error, if you overweight it, the other model has to be linear regression to be able to understand and to produce an output which is measurable to the previous one. If in here you use a support vector machine, because your loss function changes for each of model, you will have to add some more complexities to make the loss function comparable, and that adds much more complexity. If you use just decision trees, then it's a simple algorithm and you can use it directly with one line of code. And that often performs much better than serially linking it together multiple different models. So these are both most common and the most powerful types of boosting. One is called ADA boost or adaptive boosting. Other is called grad boost or gradient boosting. Gradient boosting is also, there is now a different way. There have been multiple variants of gradient boost, because every year on Kaggle, someone comes up with a little tweak version of boosting which demolishes every other algorithm out there. So I've seen last 3 years gradient boosting being twisted, contorted, modified. The current best performing algorithm is called XGBoost. XGBoost is nothing but extreme gradient boosting. So an extreme version of this gradient boosting is called XGBoost. And if you see the most popular algorithm on Kaggle, if you Google it perhaps, most widely used algorithm in Kaggle competitions. GBM, gradient boost machines. Neural networks, random forest, and GBM. Oh, it has just directly given a code, but here it generally XGBoost is the most popular, closely followed by random forest and then neural networks. Why neural networks is third? Because not many people on earth know how to use neural networks properly. There is select handful people who truly understand neural networks, and those who do, instead of doing competitions on Kaggle, they go out and set up their own companies, perhaps do something better, is my hypothesis. But yeah, neural networks are, as you would learn, the most powerful thing that has come out of machine learning so far. So without digressing much any further, adaptive boosting is, you start with a data set and every successive learner will focus on the ill-fitted data from previous learner. And then they would focus on more and more harder to fit data. And that's how you get to something which is much, much better when combined together. The different form of it is gradient boosting. In gradient boosting, every successive learner would take a modified version of data. In sense, the parts which were correctly labeled would just be removed or underweighted by a high version, by very high magnitude. So what successive learners would see is, it would see how far the prediction has been from the correct data, and it will try to reduce that distance. And sequentially, that distance becomes very close to zero. That means model accuracy has been boosted up quite a lot. So these two are the most powerful sequential stacking techniques. Sequential stacking is known as boosting. So to summarize, multiple models are better than one single model. I have shown you an example where we stack together 10 models, each with 70% accuracy. And we've seen that how we can, though, use very simple algorithms, but walk away with very high degree of accuracy. We can add together, we can stack together multiple models in two ways. Parallelly is known as bagging. Sequentially, it's known as boosting. Now, bagging, one of the most popular ways to bag anything is to repeatedly resample with replacement, grow trees on this data set, and put a constraint on branching decisions by allowing only certain random selected number of features to be available for branching decisions. This way you grow a rich, diverse forest, and then you put all of the trees in forest to vote to generate an outcome. This outcome is always all much better than any single model performance. That is bagging in summary. Boosting is stacking together models sequentially. You can stack them in two. There are two most powerful methods of stacking things sequentially. One is known as AdaBoost, also adaptive boosting. Other, GradBoost, also gradient boosting. You might see quite a lot of literature on different types of gradient boosting. One is known as CAT boost. Other is known as light GBM, light gradient boosting. Light gradient boosting tends to be much easier on your CPU. And then something called an extreme gradient boosting, XGB. While the techniques differ slightly amongst each, but the essential core concept remains same, that you pass a data set, allow a learner to learn, and the subsequent learner would learn only from the mistakes of the previous one. Whatever previous one has not classified correctly, those hard to classify things are the things that the second learner would learn, would try to predict, and so on. And these two ways, bagging and boosting, are much better than using any single algorithm in isolation. So if you want to get a visual, like bagging was fairly easy to understand when I said that you repeatedly resample, grow trees, and then take. Boosting is a little unintuitive in this diagram format, so I've put together another way of explaining it. So let's take a toy example again. I usually prefer taking something which is visually easy to understand. I'm on slide 16. You would see series of diagrams on top. So imagine this to be your data set. It has two classes of red dots and blue dots. It has only two features, each corresponding to x1 axis, x2 axis, or x-axis, or y-axis. Now, what we are doing is we are stacking together four models. Let's imagine the first one to be model 1. Now I'll ask this model to classify it into two separate categories. It might, because it's a very simple learner, it will just draw one line and it's where everything towards left is red, everything towards right is blue. Now it has classified these two reds incorrectly. So the data, when we pass on to the model 2, we will overweight these. You might see this, the way I've represented overweighting is by increasing the size of these red. Now what I would say is, regardless what, classify these reds correctly. So model 2 might draw a line towards the right side and say everything towards left now is red and everything towards right is blue. Now what this model has done is, it has ended up misclassifying the two blue dots. They have classified this as red. Now when I pass this to the third model, I would overweight these. The top overweight will still remain, but now I have overweighted the blue ones, the blue misclassified ones as well. Now I would say, regardless what, classify these four overweighted ones correctly. So the third model will draw a line and say everything below it is blue, above it is red. Now with this, it has misclassified this red and this blue. So sequentially, what is happening is, it is classifying the misclassified from the previous ones correctly, but overall there are some misclassifications. Now, if I was to combine these three models in sequential manner, I would draw this line. I would draw another vertical line for model 2. Model 1, the first line appears to the left side. Model 2, another line appears to the right side. Model 3, a horizontal line appears. Now, for each of these buckets, I would take a vote. Let's take the top bucket. So in the top bucket, what would model 1 classify it as? Model 1 would classify it as blue because the right side, this part, was blue part. But model 2 classified it correctly as red. Model 3 has classified it correctly as red. So this part, if I take a vote, it becomes red. Same way, if I want to classify anything in this part, I would ask model 1. Model 1 says it's blue. This is blue. Model 2 says it's blue. Model 3 says it's red. But I have two votes here, one vote here. So I would classify this as blue. So by stacking together sequentially these simple learners, I've been able to create a little more complicated model, which is able to cleanly segregate data now. So if model 1 was very complicated model, it would have already classified most of these red ones correctly. So this clean part, there is nothing more for model, there is not much that model 2 or model 3 can work on. They need something to work on. So to allow model 2s and model 3s or subsequent learners to learn, it is essential that each of the learners be weak. So we deliberately choose very bad models and then stack them together sequentially. In parallel, yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. I'm a little lost. I have one doubt. Sure. I thought I'll just ask. You know, just when you were on boosting techniques, that slide.
This?
The other one, next one.
This one?
Yeah. Okay. Over here, I have one question. Now, right now, what the model is trying, your boosting technique is trying to do, chop to the nearest level. Like the same thing, it can be done by a decision tree, like simple decision tree also does the same thing, chops the data multiple times to, you know, get to the nearest number, like get to the accuracy level. So why don't just use decision tree rather than using complex boosting techniques? That's what I was thinking.
This is the decision tree. Your model one is a decision tree, simple decision tree. Just like decision tree, it has decided to chop it here. It would measure Gini impurity here and here, and it would cut it here. But it's a very weak decision tree. And why we use multiple decision trees and not single? I think I would go back to this slide. Each decision tree might be of very low accuracy, but if you don't want to care about accuracy and you still want to walk away with something which is very, very accurate, you have to stack together multiple of these.
So
And that's why instead of choosing one, though everything is doing the same thing, all of these trees are capable of chopping a decision space into multiple boundaries. But when we combine them together, we get something much more accurate than any single tree. And that's why we stack together multiple trees.
Okay, so I was thinking that when we use even simple decision tree, it would chop until it gets the, I mean, using genie impurity, until it gets the purest one.
No.
Data gets overfitted, right? Because it is chopping as many as time possible to get the data, I mean, to get the accuracy higher.
Correct. That is the decision tree which you allow to grow unrestrained. But then we put a limit, right? We prune these trees. We cut these trees and don't allow them to grow much further. So if I don't allow any branching further than the first branch,
okay,
then it has just made one line, correct? Each branching is essentially one line. And I say, just draw one line and don't chop it up any further. That means I've stopped the tree. I've not allowed it to grow. So simple trees are the ones that are not allowed to grow beyond a couple of chops. We can control the number of branches that we want.
Okay. If you don't control, then it goes to the end level till it gets
100. And that's what we do in random forest where we don't control it. We don't care about how these overfit, because these are not overfitting the main data any which ways. These would overfit only a representation.
Only the representative. Okay.
Correct. But in here, because it's not pass, we are not giving a representation of data. We are directly giving access to the data. We don't want them to overfit. Or in fact, boosting, we want a tree so simple that we just want it to make one branch. One branch would mean this, just one line. I don't want it to chop like this, because if I already chop like this, for model tool, there is nothing much to learn, and hence it would not perform so well. So we want each of the models to perform to a certain extent, but not very great as well. So we restrict this tree to just one chop. It draws this line. We pass it to the second model. But now, if we use the same tree, it would again calculate Gini impurity and it will perhaps chop it like this, because this looks more appropriate than this chop. But now we have to tell, regardless what, don't misclassify these red ones. So it will draw something like this. By overweighting these, we are controlling how each model draws its decision boundaries. In a single decision tree, you cannot have any control over overweighting or underweighting of each of the data points. So that's the primary difference. But I want every one of you to be very, very clear on why do we use. So
if we stack
together n number of models, why is that we need n number of models? Why can't we just do n number of models and choose the model which is the best amongst these n? That is because, let's say if we choose n number of models, one with 50, one with 60, one with 70, one with 90% accuracy as well, your best performing model gives you 90. But if we stack them together, you'll always arrive at something which is more than the highest of these. So that's why stacking is done. So I hope that makes it clear. Is there anyone who haven't? I'm willing to go through it over and over again until all of you are very, very clear on why do we need to stack things together at all. So I take that as all of you are very clear with why do we need stacking.
I have one more question, Bharat, on boosting. Over here, are we giving any command to restrict the model, or it will restrict the model itself? Like the simple tree, it will create only one or two branch by itself.
No, or we have that control. Like generally, it has its own default. But we can override those defaults and say, do 3 branches, do 4 branches. By default, if we don't put anything, it would know what to do the best.
Okay.
Generally, defaults are chosen such that the model chooses the best for you. Mm-hmm. But you always have more control. You can change the way these trees grow. So you can put that number on. How many branches do you want each tree to make?
And in random forest, when the trees take data from the original data, that too, does it? Do we have to give any command to choose certain data?
Same way, you would have absolute control over the model by being able to choose everything. But should you not decide to get into those nitty-gritties, you can leave everything to default, mm-hmm. and it will still choose the best possible defaults for you.
Okay.
So if you see the hands-on video, there I have explained the parts where you can override the manual or the default available in the model. So finally, there is one more stacking technique. This is much more complicated than the original two ones. So in this, what we do is we break our data set into like test and train as usual, but the train part, we usually train part also we break it down into two broad folds. So we break it into half. The first half, we would train on sequence of models. So perhaps a tree and then any classifier. So this might be decision tree. This might be a stacking model, full stacked model, or it might be a KNN. And then we can use a support vector machine. We can use any heterogeneous. As long as these models are different, it's fine. We feed the outputs of each of these models onto a third meta model. So this meta model is often something like a neural network, which has the capability of taking multiple inputs from multiple models and then being still able to process and give a coherent output. Now, this is something I just wanted you guys to know, that many more complicated ways of stacking are possible. It's just that we can come back to this once you learn what neural networks is. So, but this is how generally modeling is done. You would take multiple models, stack them together serially or sequentially. The output of it is often passed through a meta model, more likely a neural network, an artificial neural network or a deep neural network. And then output of these is compared against the test data. This type of thing, stacking is a little more advanced. So I would not cover it here, but don't get confused once you see this when you're reading on your own or if you're following any book. Some of the books do talk about it. So I wanted you to be aware that these models are also possible. However, at this stage, I don't think we should cover until we learn about neural networks fully. Okay, so what do you want to do? You guys want to watch the hands-on video, try it yourself, and then get back with questions? Or you want me to start a hands-on video and show these things to you?
I think, from my understanding, I think we should do a practice by our own and then come up with questions.
So this is how your linear, this is how your end, like by the end of this course, I want you guys to do this. So this is for I can't name the company, but I'm doing something for a firm where we are trying to automate their ticket assignment, which is currently something on a system called ServiceNow. ServiceNow is most widely used. So they have 72 categories of tickets that are raised. These are people calling for, like, my laptop is not working, my BlackBerry is logged, or this thing is not working. These are support tickets. And what I'm and these are raised in 32 different type of languages. So one of the challenges is to proactively identify each language, convert them into English, and then out of these 78 odd categories. Yeah, so identify what category is, what tickets are raised, and who raises them at what level, and then try to automate this entire process that as soon as someone raises a ticket, the algorithm should know. And these are raised in these many languages, like you have Gujarati, Hindi, Hungarian, Filipino, Cebuano. I didn't even know there was a language like this. Romanian, Polish, Portuguese, quite a lot of languages. This is from across globe. This is where I use those stacking models where, so this is where I have tried, and this is just for you guys that I wanted to show that how if you just use a naive-based classifier, how can you do this? So if you use a naive-based classifier, your accuracy would be 53 because you're predicting 73 classes. You can use a KNN. Your model accuracy would be around 60. You can use support vector machines. But the most, and this is random forest. I've trained 3 different trees. This is just a representation, but I've trained 5,000 trees. And then arrived at a classification. Now it has jumped to 62. And then finally neural network. So this is how neural network would look like. So the number of parameters you're training in a linear regression would be as many as the number of features that you have. So if you have 10 features, you're training 10 parameters. Same way with KNN, your number of parameters are as many as K. When you start training neural networks, you will be training together. Like this is a very, very simple neural network. This is one of the simplest I know. Even this simple neural network, you're training 40,000 parameters, 41,000 parameters. And then you have to train it multiple times. So it would give you on first run, your loss was this, accuracy was this, training, validation, and it would keep running and learning, all the while showing how it is learning. And ultimately it shows what it has improved to. You can also use something known as convolutional network. Now this is when you stack hundreds of different type of models to reduce, let's say this was my text. These type of models actively put a context to this text, convert it in the mathematical model, do quite a lot of operations, and finally pass it to a neural network, and then it decides. So these kind of networks, so this is one of the simplest convolutional neural network. I'm training 4.6 million parameters. And then there are many, many more very, very different type of algorithms. So there is something called long short-term memory networks, which look like this. In here, even to train a model, I need to train at least 10 million parameters. So this is what your next 8-9 months would look like. But at the end of it, you should be able to do these kind of things where you can just go to your office and automate their call center function altogether. So this is, I'm training a very shallow one, 8 million parameters. So compared that to linear regression for the same model would involve me training only 6 parameters. So from 6, this is a straight jump to 8.3 million parameters. Okay, any which ways, this is quite a digression. I'll close these. So what do you guys want me to do? You want me to cover a hands-on, or you want to do it yourself? I'll leave it up to you guys. You tell me, what do you want me to do?
I think Bharath, you should cover a hands-on, because that has been always been the structure of our lectures, right? And then we could always pick up a separate example and do practice on our own.
Right. So also, because I got a lot of messages from people saying that this is the month of Deepavali and Dashera, and they would want some break. So I'm thinking of next 2 weeks as a break, so that allows you guys enough time to come up the curve and do everything until week 11 once more. Or there are a lot of people who haven't reached week 10 or week 9 as well. That allows you enough break to catch up on all of this. Then we'll have one class where we'll cover all the doubts. And there is just one more thing which I wanted to discuss perhaps. after which I would consider your supervised part of machine learning done, barring one topic where I wanted to cover the grid search. You remember when I said you can search or tune your hyperparameters automatically instead of writing for loops? That is one video I'll put up during this time. So in 2 weeks time, you should be able to do all of that. And after 2 weeks, when we regroup, let's have a quick session on question answers and whatever you have tried and has not worked. And then we jump onto, now we have covered supervised learning. We jump onto unsupervised learning. This will last again at perhaps a month and a half, after which you would have covered one milestone. That means you are aware of supervised learning and unsupervised learning, and you move on to a broad class of algorithms called neural networks. Neural networks do not care about what is the problem. They do not care about how bad or good your data is. All you do is you give them the data and it works. It's almost like a magic. If you see that same algorithm, now we have different type of algorithms for different type of problems. You have a same algorithm which can mimic all the algorithms you have learned so far. So when required, it can act like a support vector machine. When required, it can act like a linear regression. When required, it can do stacking, boosting, everything in itself. You need not teach it anything. It looks at the data. It learns, should the data be one hot encoded? Should the data be normalized? Should the data be scaled? What features are useful for, what features are not useful? You need not care about anything. And those classes of algorithms would take you at least 3 more months to learn. And that should cover your machine learning, after which we start something called deep learning. So that is the broad structure I have in mind. What do you guys think? Do you guys think in 2 weeks, if I give a break, all of you guys would be able to catch up to week 11 and be sure about whatever we have learned so far? And all this time, I would be available on WhatsApp whenever you want. If you want a small 15, 20 minute session, half an hour session in between these 2 weeks, I'm fine with that as well. So I'm leaving this fairly flexible amongst you to decide what do you guys want and how do you guys want me to take it forward. So just let me know what your thoughts are.
So Bharat, 2 weeks means that next weekend you will have a class and then you won't have class next to next weekend, right?
So I'm thinking of skipping the 7th November.
Okay.
Because that's around Dashera. And then 14th because that's around Deepavali. But 21st, everything would be done and you will be back from your Dashara and Deepavali.
Bharat, Dashera is gone.
Dashera is done. Yeah.
My God, I'm going mad with work. So then perhaps Deepavali vacation is what people were asking me. So when is Deepavali? Around 14th?
Yep, I think around that.
Yeah, so I think 7th and 14th would be no sessions. So allow you guys to enjoy your Deepavali. I have taken off 11 of your weekends. I am also feeling a little guilty of not giving you any break. So that was my thought.
Yeah, I think it could work. I mean, I'm okay with it.
Yeah, Bharat, I'm also okay with it.
But a break means break for me, not for you guys. You guys would still practice and bring yourself up to speed. Because every subsequent thing would assume that you already know all of this.
Yeah,
sounds good.
Okay, so I'm downloading this data set for hands-on video. Let's save it on my desktop. Okay, so this is, I've chosen a little complicated data set for this. I hope at least this part of screen is visible now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a German credit risk. It has original data set would contain 1,000 entries with 20 categorical symbols. Now this represents every person who has, this tracks 1,000 people who have taken credit from a bank and how likely is he to default. And this guy, Professor Hoffman, measured some of the attributes for each of the person who has taken the loan. And the idea was, using these features, can we then predict how the loan repaying ability or propensity to default of that particular person. Now, the original data set is quite complicated because Professor Hoffman was German, and Germans tend to be not so straightforward in their studies. If you read their literature or read the papers they produce, they generally tend to include quite a lot of their original data classification. So we'll be using a little tuned method of it, where everything is converted to numbers and made it somewhat more palatable. As usual, I start with NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Seaborn. These would be my plotting libraries. NumPy, Pandas are my for my operations. Sklearn model selection, import test train split, and I am importing from Sklearn tree. This is the same thing which we use to build cart. So after this, from tree, I'm importing something specialized called decision tree classifier. So now we are building a decision tree. Okay. I've read the data. This is how it looks like. The first column gives the balance in checking account. Now this is DM because German Deutschmark. This is quite old data. I haven't given, but if you read here, it will tell you the methodology of collection and when it was collected. So it was collected when Euro was not in existence. So everything is in Deutschmark. Then you have the months for which loan was taken, the credit history of person, the purpose for which loan was taken, the amount of loan taken, the saving balance, saving account balance for that person. This is also in Deutschmark. Employment duration, present income, in years at resident, how long has a person resided at the place which was given as a documentary proof before taking loan, age of the applicant, other credit means, does he have any other loan or not? What type of housing, is it owned or rented or leased? Existing number of loans, the type of job that applicant has, so skilled, unskilled management, number of dependents for that person, does that person own a phone or not? Default is the final, has that person defaulted or not? Now, using all of these features, our job is to find a model which can then predict a default. So we have 1,000 rows and 17 features. We start with describing the data. This would tell us how many missing values or not. If I see everything is 1,000, so it will show only category. It will show only numeric columns. It would not show things like these, employment duration. You see them missing. So, but you now should know and be very comfortable with identifying missing values and how to plug them in. In here, because this is a very curated data set, it doesn't have any missing values. I check the D types of each of these. Nothing looks out of, nothing looks wrong to me. The things which were marked with these kind of things are objects. Rest of it are integers. Now, I don't want any objects, so I'm converting all of them to categorical. So I've done this, so as usually I do, I take a new approach every time so that you guys have access to multiple ways of doing the same thing. Same thing can be used by pipelines or by manually replacing everything or using a loop. So for feature in creditdata.columns, it will loop through all the columns. And then we have done this extensively while identifying the types of D type and then putting, classifying them into a bucket and choosing an appropriate pipeline. So all those videos I've done 5-6 times, so you might want to watch them. But this is fairly simple. For feature in credit data dot columns, that means I can write it as anything, for X in credit data dot column, for anything. So this would, this line would loop through all the columns in this data set. And then if that column's D type is object, so if this is object, if for any column, if D type is object, what it does is it's converting that into pd.categorical. So categorical replaces strings with integers. Now this is the original data. Now it would have replaced all of this with categorical data. If I see this now, info, all of this has become category. So while you see this at the back end, it knows what category it is. So at the original, this is just a visual representation. The pandas data frame would have replaced this with 1, this with 2, this with 4, things like that. All the unknowns would also get categorized separately. So if you can just, like if I check value counts for each of these, it will show me. So there are 394 unknowns in the first column. In checking balance, there are 394 unknowns, 274 people with less than 0 Deutschmark. That means almost like 0. They don't have any checking balance available. 1 to 200 Deutschmark, these many people. Greater than 200 Deutschmark, these many people. I've done the same for every column. This is to give a sense of how, what is my data looking like. Now, I want to, now all of these have been classified as category. So this is one category, this is one category, this is one category, this is one category. Now I want to replace those categories with numbers. And I want to change everything that is unknown into a different number. So there are multiple ways. I can assign a random number to these. But inherently, I know there is some sense of structure to it. So whenever there is sense of structure, like I know for sure this 0 Deutschmark is less than 1 to 200 Deutschmark, which is less than 200 Deutschmark. Same way, poor is bad compared to good. Critical is bad compared to poor. Good is bad compared to very good. And very good is bad compared to perfect. So there is some sense of structure in this data. If I put them on random numbers or one hot encode, I would lose that structure. So to retain that structure, I want to have little more control over the numbers which are assigned to it. So I want to assign poor perhaps 0, and then perhaps critical is worst. So I want to assign 0 to critical, 1 to poor, 3 to good, 4 to very good, and 5 to perfect. Same way, 0 to this Deutsch, 0 Deutschmark, 1 to this particular category of 1 to 200 Deutschmark, and 3 to anything with more than 200 Deutschmark. Now I have another category, unknown. Now if I put 0 or less than 0 to it, it would mean I'm putting some structure and mixing that. I cannot put 4 also. So to make it totally different, usually unknowns are marked with minus 1. So I'll follow the same convention. For the things like this, car, business, reason for which,
I don't know which video you were talking about it. I think once before we had sort of talked about when you were talking about categorical data, whether we use a one hot encoding or we use 1, 2, 3, 4 type categories.
Correct.
You had mentioned that when we assign the numbers, we are sort of giving it some kind of scale, like one. 2 is greater than 2 is greater than 1, 3 is greater than 2. But to the degree to which it is better might not necessarily be communicated, like the difference between 2 and 1 and 3 and 2 is the same, but the difference between good and very good and perfect and very good might not be the same. So right. You had actually said that time that it's that one hot encoding sort of compensates for those differences.
Right. But one hot encoding compensates for those differences. It takes away the entire structure from it. So there are pros and cons. Like definitely, the distance between 1 and 2 is same as 3 and 4. Does that mean the difference between critical and poor is same as very good and perfect? So that is a broad assumption that I'm making. Now, as a traditional machine learner's approach, I would use both the methods. I would one hot encode it. I would encode it this way as well, because I know how to do both. And I would simply choose the model which gives me the best possible performance. So usually, whenever you are in doubt on what to do, this also can be done, that also can be done. A typical machine learner's way is to do both and choose the model which gives you a better accuracy.
Okay.
But technically going, if we are not sure about the distance between these, one hot encoding is the way to go. But when you choose one hot encoding, you lose a sense of structure. If these are not related at all, like in this case, why are people applying for loan to buy furniture, car, business, education, renovations, or a car zero? So if these are the reasons, then I have no reason anything is related to each other, I would more likely one hot encode it. In here, I know the distance between this and this, and the difference between this and this is same, because 0 to 200 and then more than 200, perhaps it might go to more. So yeah, if there is no linearity in the structure, I would decide, I would try both one hot encoding and the normal scaled way of representing these by numbers. I'll simply choose the model which performs better instead of speculating. But yeah, theory wise, you're right. They don't mean the same. Perhaps in this case, good, critical, poor, I might argue that yeah, these are graded in such a way that perhaps they might be equal in length. But I cannot do the same with this, because this can mean 2 million Deutschmark, or it can also mean 200 Deutschmark. So yeah, you're right. You should ideally try doing both and not make assumptions. Each individual way of encoding would carry some assumptions that if I one hot encode it, I assume that there is no linkage between these categories. If I choose labels and these labels are sequential, like 1, 2, 3, then I'm choosing that difference between this and this is same. So either which ways I'm making an assumption. A typical way, usually what I follow, is I run through all the models and simply choose the model which gives me the best performance. Saurabh, does that at least to a little extent answer your question?
Yeah, I get it. Okay, so it's not necessary that the model will be able to detect the, like, let's say it is linear and something which could be a perfect candidate for a 1, 2, 3, 4 type encoding. It's not necessary that one hot will have that level of performance if we don't feed that information.
Correct. So this stage of machine learning you guys are in, you're learning models which can do detect patterns, but models are not smart enough to detect inherent structure within data. When you learn neural networks, then you wouldn't care about these. You wouldn't tell to one hot encode. You wouldn't tell what is categorical, what is not. Your model actually will look through entire data set and would understand the exact thing that you're saying. That model being smart enough to know how to categorize these, those models would do that. But at this stage, these models are not so smart that they are able to do this. So up until now, our best strategy would be to do everything possible and then pick out the best of it. All models are flawed little in whatever assumptions they take into consideration. So if you do one hot encoding and then do model, it's also a little flawed because you have assumed no dependence. If you put 1, 2, 3, that also is a little flawed because you have assumed a very linear relationship between these. So every model is a little wrong. That's why no single model gives you 100% accuracy. But your job would be to just try out everything and pick the best possible model.
Okay, yeah, got it.
Okay, so yeah, in this, I've made the broad assumption of categorizing everything. Where have I done it? Here, I've created a replay structure So for checking, I've created dictionary. Dictionary is something which I discussed in the second video of start of this series. So it might be some time that you would have heard of dictionary. So if you want, quickly go back, watch video zero, video, the first video and second video. You would understand what dictionaries are. So I've defined a dictionary. Within each dictionary, I've defined this is for this column. I want to replace this with this. I want to replace this with this. And once I replace a structure, like imagine this just as a dictionary, the dot replace algorithm would go through these, find a checking balance, find checking balance column, and replace this with this. 1 to 200 Deutsche Mark with 2, and so on. For credit history, critical becomes 1, poor becomes 2. I've put these numbers and it will go on and replace all of this at one go. Now, if you see, I have left out this part because this is, it's the same argument which I was having with Saurabh that, you know, while some people might find it relevant that unemployed is lower than unskilled, which is lower than skilled, which is lower than management. But you might also choose make this assumption. If you don't find any reason to make this type of classification, fine. As we discussed, don't do this. All I'm asking is try out everything possible and pick out the best possible model, whatever works for you. So the parts where you are not replacing it explicitly, I have passed those columns. Like job, I'm not replacing it with this because I don't have reasons to believe that management is higher. Of course, it is higher than unemployment, but just for the sake of argument, I wanted to tell that if you find this type of linearity unreasonable, you can always leave them out and try out one-hot encoding. And then in next time when you run this, perhaps take it off from here and put it here and then rerun the entire model and then see whichever works better, works well for you. So that is going to be the approach generally I would ask you to take that. Try everything, pick out what is best. So after replacing, I'm looking at this data. Now it has converted everything into the numbers I need. And areas like job or existing loan, housing, where I one hot encoded it, it has converted into three columns. So housing other, housing own, housing rent. So this particular means it was housing own. The second row was housing own, third row was housing own, fourth row was housing others. If you see this, housing own, other, and then own rent. Housing own 3 times, other 3 times, own, and then rent. So it has one hot encoded correctly. You can use the same thing using pipelines. You're free to, now you should have enough methods in your arsenal to attack this any possible way. I've covered at least 5 to 6 ways of doing this. And as long as I would, so try out everything, you would find your own style. Like, what do you like? What is easiest for you to wrap your head around? And take that method and make it your own. And then stick to that method. So I've shown enough ways of doing it using dictionary, using pipelines, using just functions. And last time I chose a loop. So once you go through all of these practice, you will find some things are easier, some things you find difficult. And this is very different from each person. So I find using pipelines very easy. You might find using structures very easy. Someone else might find looping very easy. So it really depends. These come from different thought processes. So if you are more recursive in your thought, you might like loops. If you are linear thought, very, very clean in your thought process, you might tend to like pipelines, is what I've seen looking at many people who do that. So I've given you enough number of ways to do it. So you choose what works well for you. But either which ways, we have converted our input data set into numbers. Numbers is what now we can feed onto algorithms and start working on it. So this is how the info looks like. It has swelled up from 9 to 28 now. That's primarily because of one hot encoding. But now what I wanted to check was everything should be an integer now. So u int would mean unsigned integer and int would just mean 64. So when your algorithms convert anything to one hot encoding, it takes up very, very less space because it's a sparse matrix. So these get saved as unsigned integer, but think of just all of this as integer only. And then we split our data by first taking off. I save the target column, which was default, save it into Y, and rest of the columns into X. And then I use test train split to split it at the ratio of 30. Now, last time I remember I chose only 20% because there was quite large amount of data for me to allow me to do that. Like here, I don't have that luxury. I have just 1,000 rows and I want to keep at least 300 of them to get an accurate gauge of how well my algorithm has performed. So I choose my test size to be 30% of the full data set. Random state for repeatability. I already removed this. Let me quickly check if I had removed. Okay, I had already removed it. White train. Okay. I've split this and then I instantiate as the first step in any algorithm. You instantiate, you bring the model alive. So I've brought the model alive. The model I'm using is decision tree classifier. This is just one tree. So decision tree classifier, I want the branching criteria to be genie. Now, because there is a lot of randomness in this algorithm, I have to give a random state. Every time things happen randomly, the algorithm would always let you provide a random state. Just like test train split, because it shuffles and randomly creates a split, it allows me to give pass on a hyperparameter called a random state so that every time I pass this, the output would be same. Same way for repeatability, because the calculation of Gini and the branching happens a little randomly, it allows me to give a random state. So I pass on one for no particular reason. This can be anything, but this is how I brought my tree alive. If you are ever in doubt on what to pass, you can always look up the documentation by pressing shift tab. And then here, if I now here criteria equal to Gini. Because it's already provided, this means this is a default value. If I don't provide a criteria, it will by default take Gini index. Now, Gini can be replaced by entropy as well. There are entropy types of splits. I showed you calculation of Gini. Gini should mostly work much better than entropy, so I stick with Gini. It gives quite a lot of parameters. Now, this parameter allows all these parameters allow you unprecedented control over your tree. So, Naseem, this is what you were asking. Max depth. How deep you want the tree to cut? As of now, if you put none, which is default, it is allowed to grow unrestrained. If you put three, it will do only three branches and then stop. So, this is how you control how deep your tree is. Is this what you were asking back then, Naseem?
Yes. Yep.
Okay. Same way, minimum sample split. This is how many observations should be there at a node for the node to consider branching further. Min sample leaves. What is the number of leaves beyond which it should not chop further? Maximum features. So remember when I said in random forest, we choose a random number of features to be available for calculating the Gini impurity and thereby considering these features for split. This is how you control that. As of now, it's unrestrained. That means every feature would be used and model would try chopping it on every feature and then see Gini impurity and then come up with the best chop. But left unattended, it allows all the features to be available. In random forest, we will control this. We don't want it to be We don't want all the features to be available, but we'll come to that. So here, it has got very good documentation on each of these. What are these? And what happens once you change any of these? You can read through it. It's a very interesting one. And you can try out various of these permutation and combinations of these and see how your tree reacts to your data. So for now, I've just given a random state and criteria to be Ginny, and I fit this on my train and test data. Once fitted, I predict both test and train part of it. The test part of predictions gets stored in ypredtrain. The train part of the predictions gets stored in predictTrain, and the test part of the data gets stored in yPredictTest. Now, once I do this, I want a classification report for both of these. How did my model perform on train? How did I perform on test? So this is for training part. As expected, this should come as no surprise that we have 100% accuracy, because if a tree is allowed to grow unrestrained, it will chop up your decision tree. It would chop up your decision space into so many parts that every space would be 100% pure. But this has captured both the noise as well as the information in your data. It has overfit. How do you know it has overfit? When you do fit this model onto training part, you see your scores tanked now. It's only 69. So in absolute way, 70 is a good score relatively. But when you see your scores very, very different, if your training scores are way, way higher than the test scores, that is a case of overfitting. You should discard the model immediately or tune it further. So how do we visualize it? Before I go on to the methods of tuning it, I want to show you, you can visualize these decision trees. So all I have done is pass this model. My model was dtree. So I've just used tree.plottree decision tree. If I do this, it has given me a lot of text. So it gives me actually at every split, what is the Gini? How many samples on the left side of the node? How many samples on the right side of the node? What was Gini for each of these? And reading through it, you will get a rough understanding of how the branching decisions have happened. And at the end of all these, you see how long this is? Now, can you see that this has become so small that you can't even read it? Perhaps you won't be able to see it. This is the complexity of tree that it has arrived at. Look at the size and magnitude of this tree. And this is just one tree. So this is how much it has chopped up your decision space into millions of spaces. So much that you can't even see what individual tree is. So now we want to chop this tree. We don't want to allow it to grow so big that it overfits. So now I'm controlling the depth. I don't want it to grow unrestrained, like stop after three chops. And that's all I want you to do. So though you have available to you to choose multiple things, you can choose max depth, min split, minimum weight fraction, maximum number of features available. You can try any of these, and all of these are various ways of constraining your tree growth. I want to start. Usually the way you should go about is start with one, experiment. Put three, put four, put five, and see what direction leads you to betterment. And then you would often see three gives a good result, four gives even more, five becomes even better result, but six again degrades. So you know max depth somewhere around five is good. Then you add one more constraint to it. Then you say, okay, let's try minimum sample split. Then you put two, then you put four, five, and then try on. And that's the way you... via some series of trial and error, you sooner or later hit an appropriate configuration for which your tree just is appropriate. So with this constraint, I have again instantiated a classifier, but I have now regularized. The typical machine learning term to constrain anything is known as regularization. You will hear this term very often. So constraining any model by imposing these type of constraints is also called regularizing a model. So I have called it D-tree R, R for regularized tree. I've instantiated it with these parameters. I fitted it on train test, and then I'm predicting. It's the same code which I've used earlier. It's the only difference is this particular sentence, this particular parameter. So I run this, and now you see, this was my previous model. Look at the amount of chops. Look at the number of, so each line is a chop, is a branch. So look at the number of times it has branched. And now because I have asked it to be branched only three, so first branch leads to two particular, so this is the root node, and then a branch would lead to two nodes, and then for left branch, right branch, and so on. And now I can same way, I've just passed the model DTR to this command, tree.plot_tree, and this would plot it for me. So this is how the tree looks like. I started with this, the genie at my root node. Now, though algorithm calculates all of these, I would still strongly advise that you go back to the video in which I had a very simple toy example, and we hand calculated genie impurities. It is very important because genie is not only used in this, genie is used extensively across multiple places. Regardless what you are doing, perhaps if you are in this domain of machine learning, computation, data science in general, you will repeatedly come across this. It's always good to have that mental model of what genie impurity is, how to calculate it by hand and all. That often is the difference between someone who knows what they're doing compared that to someone who just would Google and copy paste this and arrive at this. So do watch those videos, a fairly interesting and fun example I've covered. So either way, this is the tree, chop one, chop two. So at the second chop, each of these are into four, and this is the third level. So at third level, it has stopped. Now let's see how is the accuracy of these. Here, I have downloaded the classification report. Now, if you see, my training and test scores are almost identical, though they are much lesser than the 100% we got. But our training, our testing, which is actual measure, has improved drastically. From 69, now it has become 74. So this has improved. And definitely, this is not an overfit, so we can generalize, we can use this model. So I don't really care how big this number is. As long as this is somewhere around the vicinity of training, that means my model is not overfitting and it's good to use. So this is a clear indication of how if we prune a tree, if we don't allow it to grow unrestrained, we can prevent the overfit. So here we have learned how to grow trees. Now with trees, you have another. So if I pass on D-tree, my model, and give a method called feature importance, it gives me an array of giving what features are more important for decision making. I've just tagged these arrays against each of the column here. So I've just used a data frame. Data frame first column was this D-tree dot feature importance. This is the first column. And the second column, the index column, is the usual the column names. So I create a data frame with column names and importance as values. Now this clearly makes the entire model very explainable by saying checking balance is the most important feature in decision making if a person would default or not, followed by months of loan duration, followed by the credit history. So top three things I would check immediately when a person comes to take loan are these three things. If I want to go further, then I would check for saving balance and the purpose being business or not. So this also gives you what are the relative importance of each of the features in your overall decision making. So I always use a pd.crosstab. This is to do this. And why I want to you guys to use this every time is you should be fairly comfortable hand calculating accuracy, precision, and recall for each of models. So while this report, classification report, gives both precision, recall, and F1 as well as accuracy, you should be able to hand calculate these so that you form a mental model of, compared to 75% accuracy, what does the precision of 81 and recall of 85 truly mean? So you should be very, very thorough with these. Because often when you start working on these, people would just talk about precision and recall and you wouldn't have time to sit, recalculate, analyze. You should have a very strong mental model on what precision recall means. So hand calculating these values often give you that mental model required to process this subconsciously every time you hear these terms. Next was bagging. If I want to use the same model, but I want to now use bagging technique, I want to stack multiple of these together. I want a base estimate. So simple way, this is entire bagging. You see how simple this is? Though our concept was pretty deep and profound, implementation is 4-5 lines, and that's how your entire machine learning is going to be. So I import bagging classifier from sklearn ensemble. I bring it to life by instantiating it. The hyperparameters I pass is, what is my base estimator? So I want my base estimator. Remember, bagging ultimately means all the, where has it gone? Bagging was making multiple trees. So each of these are called base estimators. So I said for random forest, let's choose all the base estimators to be decision trees. That's what I've done here. So I have chosen decision trees to be my base estimator. How many trees do I want to grow? I want to grow 50 trees. And because I sample repeatedly with replacement and that is purely random, I give a random state so that every time I pass one as a random state, my experiment, the outcome is predictable. And then it becomes the same. Once I bring the model alive, I fit it on train and then I store the predicted values onto ypredict and I create a classification across tab. Or I can do a classification report as well. Let's do both. So I have created my model and fitted it. I've stored the predicted values here. My model accuracy is 77.33. I can, in fact, download the entire classification report. Classification report. So here, this is my classification report. I have 77% accuracy, 77. Precision and recall are extremely good for majority class, class 0, but little bad, little poor for class 1. I will leave it to you to figure out what do these mean for you. So what does each of these four figures mean? And you should be able to back calculate these four using this table. Okay, so that's all there is to bagging. While we spent 2 hours discussing bagging and boosting, this is all how to implement it. That's about it. You can change it to 500. Let's see. Actually, let's grow 500 trees. Okay. So from 50 to 500, if we jump, our accuracy has increased, actually decreased by 1%. So now it's 76, but my lower class precision and recalls have gone up. That is why I was saying that these figures usually would give you a sense of, are you, how willing are you to risk a bad loan to not let go of a potential business customer? Or how comfortable are you saying, no, I will not give you a loan, though you are, do you look fine, but I want to be absolutely sure of you not defaulting. So those kind of things can be quantified using precision recall for both 0 and 1. So that's why you should know these and how to calculate these. But this is how you implement bagging classifier. Let's do boosting. I'll cover adder boost and the gradient boost. I'll post some material. You can pursue it. It's almost the same. In fact, I'll discuss gradient boost, but extreme gradient boost, light gradient boost, I'll leave it up to you. On material is plenty available. I'll close this session by covering random forests. So bagging we have covered. Boosting. Boosting is the sequential stacking. So from same ensemble module, I import adder boost classifier. I bring it to life. I want my base estimator to be D tree. N estimators. How many of these trees I want to be stacked sequentially? 10. Again, because there is some amount of randomness in decision trees, a random state. Once I instantiate it, I fit it on my train, and then I use it to predict on my test data, and I print out the scores. So it has given me 68.66 on the test. Now, let's see. You remember I said decision trees for boosting, for sequential stacking, we want each learner to be very, very poor. So what we do is, instead of this unrestrained decision tree, you remember we cut it and we built another model at 3 chops only and we called it D3R. Let's use the model which we have built as base estimator. So now you get it. How do you create different models? You can pass on any estimator. Now I'm passing R estimator. So here in boosting, instead of D3, now I'm passing that pruned decision tree, the D tree R. This tree was allowed to grow only till 3 chops. So this is a relatively weak learner compared to the previous one. Let's see if we can improve our score. So in this case, our score has actually decreased, but not by a huge margin. So from hundreds of chops, if we bring it down only to 3 chops, perhaps it has not lost much of its accuracy. Let's see if we can if I leave this empty. So remember I said, if we don't give anything, these classifiers always choose the best. So if I read the documentation of adder boost classifier, if I don't choose anything, if I don't choose a base estimator, it's none, then it takes a tree which has only one chop. So if you read this documentation, it will be written here. So boosting is terminated much early, and it would use a tree with only one chop. So this time I rerun this model without this as well. So I've copy pasted the same thing actually here. And I have not provided a base estimator. I've let it choose my base estimator. The base estimator chosen by adder boost is a D tree, but this D tree is allowed to grow only once. So it has only one branch. That's all. I have 10 such estimators, and let's see. Now you see from our first one, this was unrestrained tree, 68.6. This was a tree with 3 chops, 67.33. Tree with just one chop, 74. That's a 10. That's almost a 8% boost in our algorithm accuracy, just by taking a lot of very, very dumb trees together. This was a smart tree. It grew unrestrained, but it overfit. This was a very, very good tree. It has very good accuracy, but it's not even overfitting now. But if we dumb these trees down, we take a lot of dumb learners and then stack them together. Now you see how a sequence of very dumb learners would outperform even the best learner. So this was our best learner. But if we stack together multiple dumb learners, we gained 8% just by stacking together multiple dumb learners. So this is the power of stacking. And so this is how we did with adder boosting. Gradient boosting is almost the same. It's just that instead of adder boost, I import gradient boost classifier. I instantiate. I need not give anything except for the number of trees or number of these models I want stacked together. These are all sequentially stacked, of course. So if I just let it choose for me, it would choose appropriate base estimators and everything. It's giving similar results to my adder boost, almost same results. So try both gradient boost, adder boost, and your bagging as well. And then see what works best for you. So far for us, bagging has worked best. Let's see. You remember I told random forest is a special class of bagging classifier where each of the base estimators are D trees. But one more constraint is we don't allow it to choose all the features to grow. We put that constraint as well. And then Naseem, you had a question that how do we choose number of features yes. to be used for branching. So yes, here sir. You go. So we import random forest classifier from Ensemble. We bring it to life. Here, I am giving number of estimators. I want 50 trees, random state 1, and here max features. By max features, I mean I want it out of the how many features we had?
17 earlier.
28.
After one input.
Out of 28, I'm allowing it to choose only from a random 12 while doing the branching decision making. So if I do this, my accuracy even jumps further than this. So yes, I've been able to get another 3.6, another 4% if I may. So I've been able to squeeze another 4% by introducing additional level of randomness onto number of features. So this is very counterintuitive. We are increasingly adding more randomness to our models. We are making them increasingly dumb. But somehow when we stack together a lot of them, our performance keeps going up. So this is what I tried to explain in that slide where I was explaining why is it when we stack multiple dumb models, do we get a better model? So this was a hands-on demonstration of stacking multiple models together, both sequentially and parallelly. In sequence, we have seen both adder boost and gradient. We also saw how in sequential stacking of models, that is in adder boost and gradient, your learners should be weak for your output to be even better. So we made them weak by passing on a very, very dumb decision tree with only one shot by not mentioning it at all and let it choose the default one. The default one is with one chop only, and that performed the best so far. And then in sequence, in parallel stacking, which was also bagging, we just ran a bagging, but here we passed on first a deep tree because we don't care about how deep it is. It might not overfit because it's working on a representation of data, not the entire data. So we don't care whether it overfits the representation or not. So we have grown a tree. We've checked it was performing real good, but we added another set of randomness by putting a constraint on the branching decision making by allowing only 12 features to be made available for branching. Now, this is the best performing model so far. So by not changing much, but increasing the way we think about models by stacking them sequentially, parallelly, by adding randomness, we are extracting more performance. And after 2 weeks, when we meet, I'll cover and I'll post these videos perhaps next week only on how do you do grid search. So instead of this, if you had just a set of numbers, let's say you just need to say max features 0 to 24, try out everything, come back to me with the best possible feature. Same way, n estimators 50 to 5,000, go back, come back to me with the best feature. I'll upload that video. It's a fairly simple technique. You can watch the video and try these on your own. So I really hope you guys are enjoying and learning. As much as learning is important, so is it to keep it in a state which brings joy to the learning. I don't want to take it away. So 2 weeks break. In these 2 weeks, I hope you have fun watching the previous videos, practicing what we have learned so far, and don't forget to feel how proud you should be of yourself. Exactly 11 weeks back, none of you had the ability to code in Python. I think all of you are not only using Python, but using it to predict things in multiple different ways, using some of the most complicated things on earth. Machine learning, when I said I can teach it, it's very easy. Well, I lied. The reason why there are few people who do machine learning and why it's the hottest job is perhaps because it's one of the most difficult things to wrap the head around. As we go on from here, things would become increasingly complex. But I would try to keep it at same level of simplicity as I've kept so far. So with that, if you have any questions, I'll take them now. Or otherwise, I'll wish you happy Deepavali and 2 weeks of break from my horrible voice, perhaps.
No question, Bharat.
No questions, Naseem. So I expect you understand everything now.
I'll try this. I think you have already uploaded that video.
Right.
And so on. I have tried once. I'll try again. Before, close, I was getting into that, like how to choose a appropriate number on maximum feature random state. But thanks, you reminded about that grid line. I'll look into that also.
It's called a grid search. You can Google it as well. If you don't want to wait for me to upload the video, feel free to Google search it. It's very, very easy.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Thanks.
Any other question anyone might have? Okay, so we generally see what I see, and this is not abnormal. As we move along, you will continuously see the group becoming smaller and smaller. I tend to not worry about it much because people have commitments. They would want to spend their time. They might not be able to extract so much time for learning. And this is a complicated thing. So what I want is, if at any point of time you feel that things are moving too fast, they are becoming a little complicated to wrap head around, don't think that it's because you haven't watched videos, because you haven't asked. It's as simple as that. As soon as you ask, let me try explaining things to you. So don't hesitate asking questions when something becomes a little difficult. And don't ever hesitate to tell that we need a break, perhaps a week, so that we can catch up. Otherwise, I would not know and I will continue at my same pace. Okay, so I guess I will see you guys after 2 weeks.
Sure, Bharat. Happy Deepavali to you too.
Thanks, Bharat. Happy Diwali to you too.
Same. Happy Deepavali, everyone. Take care. Spend your 2 weeks wisely and be careful during Deepavali.
Yeah,
man. You too, Bharat. Thanks.
Thanks. Take care. See you soon.
Thanks.
Thanks, man.